Drain-induced barrier lowering is a curious and extremely important secondary effect in short-channel transistors. So we reached an expression for subthreshold current, which included an exponential factor, actually an exponential in a power of 10, 10 to the power of minus V threshold over S. And S is called the subthreshold swing, and it is equal to 60 eta millivolt at room temperature. So what does S represent? S represents the amount of voltage necessary to swing the leakage current, the subthreshold current specifically, by a decade. So we reached the conclusion that at threshold voltage, the amount of subthreshold current flowing is equal to I threshold times W over N. And what we are interested in is what value of current we will observe at VGS equals zero, which we call I off, which is the off current. So basically, the amount of voltage between V threshold and zero volt is the shift that we observe in the current. And S represents the amount of voltage we need to see to reduce the current by tenfold. So the more S's we have between V threshold and zero volt, the lower the off current we will observe. And so it's in our interest to have S as small as possible. And the only way to control S other than temperature is through eta, and eta is equal to 1 plus C depletion over C oxide. So eta is at best equal to 1. So eta is basically greater than or equal to 1. And eta is equal to 1 when C oxide is much greater than C depletion. And this starts to give us an idea of what subthreshold conduction is about. So subthreshold conduction is about a battle. It's about a war that is being waged between two terminals or two capacitors for control over the channel. One is C oxide, which is trying to control the charge in the channel, and the other is C depletion, which is trying also to control it through the body. And so we have C depletion capacitively coupling to the channel through the depletion zone, and we have C oxide through the oxide. And so it makes sense to increase C oxide because that will increase the control of the gate on the channel, which allows the gate to more effectively shut down the channel when we reduce our voltage below V threshold, which is why we have to keep T ox small. So there are two main reasons we want to keep T ox small. The first is that this increases the amount of coupled inversion charge when the transistor is on because it increases C oxide. This leads to more on current, which leads to lower delay, but also it reduces subthreshold current by increasing the control of the gate on the channel, allowing it to more effectively shut it down. Now, if we take a look at the expression of threshold voltage, so this is threshold voltage for any transistor. It's equal to 2, the body potential, which is the deep bulk potential of the transistor, plus square root 4qNA, which is the level of doping in the body, permittivity of silicon multiplied by the body potential of silicon divided by C oxide minus V flat band. So these three terms represent three different things. The first term represents the amount of bending necessary in the surface of the substrate in order to introduce strong inversion, making the substrate as N as it was originally P. The middle term represents the amount of charge coupled through the oxide to the channel. And the third term represents the difference between the work functions of the substrate and the gate. If we look at the expression of V threshold, we find that V threshold is not a function of transistor size. So it's not a function of W or L. When we considered body effect, we found that, the threshold voltage is a function of source potential. but at no point did we find that it was a function of either W or N. When we started scaling down transistors, we started to notice something a little bit weird. If you plot V threshold versus L, the channel length, we started to notice that as L started to decrease, the threshold voltage started to decrease. And of course, the value of threshold voltage I'm drawing here is the expected value of threshold voltage. And so if this was the expected value of threshold voltage, we found that we have a smaller value for threshold voltage. This is actually something, this is a phenomenon that is part of a bunch of phenomena called short channel effects, one of which is actually velocity saturation, which we have already discussed. But this is, looking at this graph is actually a little bit distracting, because the fact of the matter is this graph does not represent a dependence of threshold voltage on channel length. In reality, it represents a dependence of channel threshold voltage on drain potential. And so this is actually drawn if VDS is not equal to zero. Specifically, it will be clearest when VDS is equal to VDD. In fact, what we should see is if we start to plot V threshold versus VDS, what we notice is that we have a dependence of V threshold on VDS. The higher the VDS, the lower the V threshold. The fact that we noticed this when we plotted V threshold versus channel length is because this phenomenon, which also exists for long channel transistors, only manifests when the potential, the VDS, is very large. And so for a large channel transistor, you will notice that V threshold is pretty much constant, and then maybe you will notice some dependence at very high values of VDS. So high, in fact, that they are beyond normal operating potentials. They are even beyond normal potentials at which the transistor will break down. So this was an effect that you did not notice in long channel transistors, but is pretty obvious in short channel transistors. It's really a huge deal. And the reason it is a huge deal is not because we see V threshold being modulated with VDS. That in and by itself is a problem. But the problem is when you consider a transistor that looks like this, this is an off transistor. But if there's a channel, if there's a drain potential, a high drain potential VDD here, then the threshold voltage that you observe for this transistor is different from the threshold voltage that you observe for this transistor. So it's the same transistor, just with a VDD of 0 volt. In fact, if this is V threshold 2 and this is V threshold 1, what we will notice is that for the transistor with 0 drain potential, we have a V threshold of V threshold 1. And again, we define V threshold as the point at which the current is equal to I threshold times W over L. For the same transistor with a drain potential of VDD, we notice that the threshold voltage drops. It does not increase, it drops to V threshold 2. And if the two transistors have, even if they have the same subthreshold swing, what this leads to is a much larger off current observed for the transistor with high drain potential. And so we see a higher off current. How much higher? Exponentially higher, because the subthreshold current is exponential. And so this phenomenon is a specific phenomenon is called drain-induced barrier lowering. And the problem with drain-induced barrier lowering is that it greatly increases subthreshold current. And in order to reduce subthreshold current, we then have to make the gate oxide thinner, increase the value of eta, decrease the value of eta actually, but decreasing the thickness of the oxide will increase tunneling current. And so we found ourselves in a situation where we have to have a high leakage current, a high total leakage current, because recall that leakage current is the totality of all leakage mechanisms. It is at least the total of gate tunneling and subthreshold current. And so we are in a situation here where drain-induced barrier lowering is increasing subthreshold current. To combat subthreshold current, we find ourselves increasing tunneling current. And so there's no way to reduce the sum of leakage currents. And so we have to look at drain-induced barrier lowering, which is abbreviated into DIBL. We have to look at it much deeper, and we have to develop models to understand it and then to combat it. There are three ways in which we can visualize DIBL, which I will consider in the following videos, but the three ways are the capacitive coupling model. And the capacitive coupling model is actually the model that gives you the most physical feeling for why drain-induced barrier lowering happens. It just gives you an understanding of why this occurs and why it occurs in transistors with short channel length. And the second way to look at it is through the charge sharing model. And the charge sharing model is a little bit less intuitive, a little bit less in depth than the capacitive coupling model, but actually it has a great advantage, which is that it allows us to develop an analytical model for DIBL. And the third way to look at it, which is my favorite way, is using band diagrams and using the bending that band diagrams observe as we apply larger drain potential. This is my favorite way to look at DIBL because it is a tightly knit to the naming of the phenomenon, drain-induced barrier lowering, and because it gives you a great insight about why this happens specifically in short-channel transistors.